After reflecting on the last 5 decades, I've come to realize that I have a story. One of my music and my sound, and the marvelous collaborations with friends and colleagues. With a little help from these friends, I will share with you the journey that has shaped my musical life. I suppose every musician has a story, and my story is not new, but it is mine. Welcome to The Path Taken, hosted by Tom Farley and Alton Riddick.
All right, Tom, well, you know, how old were you when you took an interest in music in general?
I was pretty young. I can remember going to my grandmother's house. My grandmother and my Aunt Betty both play piano for their tabernacle church, so to speak. And my Aunt Betty had a friend named Jerry who played guitar. And I used to sit and watch them. Nobody in my immediate family actually played an instrument except for singing, so to speak. So I watched them, and they were definitely, you know, into what they were doing, and they got such joy out of it. That really made me start thinking about an instrument, even though I didn't think I had the capability to do anything. But also in church, I used to love sitting next to my mom. We used to love singing hymns together. And we were in a Baptist church at the time, and the Baptists have great hymns. So we used to really enjoy singing together. She had a beautiful voice. And so that kind of, you know, started me on a musical trend. There was always music around the house, not rock and roll, but there was always music around the house. And of course, that just kind of helped fuel all the interest, so to speak.
Well, the music around the house, was that like more of the same, or was it a little different? I know it wasn't rock and roll, but what did you have? Blues? Did you have any kind of classical or any orchestral stuff, or what was going on?
Well, my dad was a country music, he just loved country music. He used to work out in the garage with WCMS on the radio, singing along to, you know, Hank Williams and Ernest Tubb, and he couldn't carry a tune in a bucket, but he loved the music and loved getting into it. My mom was into more like show tune stuff. I remember one of the albums she had had favorite show tunes, and one of them was a song called Harrigan. Harrigan, that spells Harrigan.
Okay.
I used to listen to that song. I really liked the tempo of it. And I, as a matter of fact, when I was in drama class in high school, I used that song to do a lip sync thing as part of one of my projects. So, I mean, and so there was like that kind of music and country music. Wasn't any rock and roll until we actually got our own, like, you know, crystal AM, FM, you know, radios with the earbuds so we could listen to what we wanted to. And that's when rock and roll started entering in.
Okay, I hear that. I don't mean to laugh, but I keep hearing this. I keep getting this image of your dad and the dad in Footloose, just like, we ain't going to have no dancing, we ain't going to have no rock and roll. So I'm just saying, I'm just kidding, man.
No, I understand exactly what you're saying. But, you know, it's... Yeah, it was humble beginnings, but, you know, I definitely loved the music that was around the house. And they had a decent record player with a decent set of speakers on it. So the fidelity actually was a little better than most people would have around the home.
That's a great segue because, you know, just kind of give us an idea of what your teen years were like or your adolescence in general. What was it like?
I had a rather, you know, don't want to say lonely, but I would just say isolated set of teen years. When I was younger, I had a lot of weight on me, and that just really limited my social engagement, so to speak. I used to go out and play in the yard and stuff with my buddies, but as time went on, they got other interests like girls and stuff like that, which basically I was interested in, but really didn't have any opportunities because, you know, the fat guy doesn't really get the dates and the fat guy doesn't get, invited to the party, so to speak. So, you know, in a lot of ways, I found my own interests, so to speak. Music, of course, would eventually be one of them. But it was, you know, I stayed at home, watched a lot of television, ate a lot of ice cream. And, you know, until my parents eventually, right before my junior year in high school, they got me on a diet program, which was very, very effective. They were very, very good and supportive with it. Dad built a little little slab out in the backyard and put up a basketball thing. And so I was able to get exercise, which I wasn't getting before.
Right.
Before you knew it, you know, when I got into my junior year in high school, I had grown 4 inches and lost 35 pounds. So I was on my way to, you know, taking the shape that I'm in now, which of course changed my life in terms of social interaction.
Absolutely. Okay. Why did you choose music over any other hobby or interest that you had at the time?
Well, I mean, you know, being on my own a lot, music, no matter what instrument, you know, I would choose would be something I could do on my own. I mean, it's nice to collaborate and stuff like that, but I didn't know that. If I was going to play an instrument, I could do it by myself. I could get personal enjoyment out of it. There's a creative angle there that and learning a skill set, which basically most people do on their own anyway, unless they go and take lessons, which I never took lessons. So at the end of the day, it was a nice way for me to engage in something really positive, something that I really enjoyed, you know, music, and also a way to, you know, if I wanted to, I could take one of my other interests, which was writing poetry. I could take that and actually apply it to a musical situation and actually start writing songs. And that was a good thing, too. Of course, all these things over time led me to different people and different situations as far as just writing or playing or whatever. But, you know, music was really a pretty easy choice because it was something I enjoyed and something I could do on my own.
Okay. Well, let's go back a little bit. You said something about poetry, and I'm kind of like, that doesn't happen just because it just happened. So where did you find an interest in that, and how long did it take you to develop that?
I've always had an interest in poetry. I mean, I used to write poems when I was a real little kid. As I started getting into, I guess, what would be considered junior high school and high school, I got a little bit more serious about it. Plus, you know, not having a lot of social interaction, poetry was a way for me to express myself. And, you know, of course, it was pretty simplified in its approach, but it did what it was supposed to do, I guess, you know, for me and in a way of helping me to express myself. Then when I got to high school, I found that there were other people who wrote poetry too. Almost all of them were girls. And so we would share our poetry. And so I got a little bit of confidence because they seemed to like what I was writing. I liked and learned from what they wrote. And also I could find out more about, you know, I guess you could say relationships between men and women, even though I didn't have any at the time. They would speak and write about their interactions with the opposite sex, so to speak.
Okay.
And I could learn from that.
Okay. Now, to this point, you're not playing an instrument. You're a listener. You're an avid collector. You're writing poetry, but you're not playing an instrument.
No. Uh-uh.
Okay. So what was the moment? What led to you actually playing an instrument and that instrument being guitar, but what led to that moment?
My initial first interest was in drums. I didn't have the money to buy a whole set, but I did have the money to buy a snare drum. And I had two friends in the neighborhood. One is Robbie Turner. He had a full set of drums, and basically people came over to his garage to jam. And when they were on break, he would allow me to get on his drums and bang on them and have a, you know, get a sense of what a full set would be like. And there was an older guy down the road. I guess he was in his early 20s. His name was Charlie. I can't remember his last name, who had a full set of Ludwigs, and they sounded incredible. I mean, Ludwig was the drum back then. And he had them set up in one huge room in his house. And so me and a bunch of other guys would go over there, like Robbie would go over with me just to check out what the drums were all about. And that was really, really a cool thing to do. So basically drums was the thing. But then I had a moment. And the moment was, I have a good friend from high school who lived on the same street as I did. His name is Ken Reitler. Eventually ended up being an astronaut on the space shuttle. He's an exceptional man. But in his early youth, he basically put together a guitar with a, you know, makeshift pickup, and you know, he had the pickup hooked up to an old tube radio. And at the end of the day, it was really kind of neat because, you know, he would sit there. He invited me over. He would sit there and he would try and make chords and stuff like that. And it was the first amplified instrument I'd ever been around outside of the guys that were playing in Robbie's garage. And they were all playing electric guitars, and an acoustic was something that was really quite new to me. So I sat back, and he went, left the room for something. I picked up his guitar and started plunking around. You know how you do, put your finger on a single string on a fret and see how it changes. When he came back in, he said, you know, you need to put that down. I said, yeah, you don't know what you're doing. You'll never know what you're doing. At the end of the day, this is not going to be something you can get into. And so he grabbed it and started, you know, playing it again himself. And I thought to myself, you know, the hell with you. I said, this is something that if I want to get into it, I'm going to get into it. And there was something about that little moment, that the sound and the feel of the instrument and all of that stuff, that was really quite attractive. So I went home and I grabbed my snare drum and had mom and dad put a little article or, you know, for sale thing in the paper, sold the snare drum, started mowing lawns and bought my first guitars. And, you know, from that point on, it was just a learning experience. The first was an electric guitar, which was a terrible instrument. I didn't know what I was doing. The strings were like way off the fretboard, made my fingers bleed, hard to keep in tune. And then I went the classical route, and the classical guitar was warmer and much more in tune with my poetic, you know, ambition, so to speak. And so it also allowed me to really enjoy playing without having the pain and blood and sweat and tears involved. It was a much nicer instrument to play.
Yeah.
Well, okay, so you're playing, you're not blood, sweat, and tearing it anymore as much as you were at the beginning anyway. So your guitar is set up, the action's good, you know what you're doing, you have the right instrument for what you actually want to accomplish. So what's the first song that you learned?
First song that I learned was Remember the Alamo by Donovan. It was really, really simple song, simple chords, and it was in my vocal range. I don't know, whether or not I did that consciously or unconsciously, but I learned that one, and then followed up with the Battle of New Orleans, which was, a very popular song. It wasn't rock and roll, but it was definitely a more rocker than, Remember the Alamo. And so I learned that song too, which was fun. I got into doing something that most people don't do, which is strumming my classical guitar, which did not have a pick guard. I scraped the hell out of the front face of that guitar, doing, rhythm and stuff, but, it served its purpose. Those two songs were the first ones that I actually felt like I was successful with. Couldn't sing worth a darn, really, to tell you the truth, but, I just enjoy getting into them as a first shot, so to speak.
Okay, well, just for my own sake, how long did it take you to learn those songs?
To learn the songs themselves?
Yeah.
Just to learn the chords probably took, to get them to where I didn't have a bunch of buzzes and stuff like that, probably a couple of weeks. I mean, they were only three chord songs with maybe a minor chord thrown in there. The rhythm and the tempo and stuff like that were really, really quite good as far as just what I was capable of at the time. And so a couple of weeks on each song to really get to where I could actually play it without any major screw ups. And so I felt pretty successful as far as the ability to put it together at that time, which was, slow, but sure, the whole process was actually pretty positive. So as long as I was making headway, that's all that really mattered.
Okay, I hear that, because I have a fascination with guitar players. I love seeing y'all do your thing, and I always wonder, especially in the beginning stages when you don't have the muscle memory, you don't have a lot of knowledge, and it's just like you're just one finger at a time to build a chord. How do you go from that to being able to string three or four together? So I just wanted to know for my own personal benefit.
Skill set is slow and painful in developing, but once you've arrived, once you got some calluses, once you've, figured out the chords and make them do without buzzing, then you're pretty much on your way.
So was songwriting ever part of your musical interest? Did you want to play other people's songs? I mean, was that your initial thought was just, I want to learn all my favorite songs, or did you really use that as a stepping stone to write your own? Did you have that feeling?
Oh, that's a really good question. I did have that feeling, especially with all the poetry that I was writing. I felt like some of that was actually just tailor-made for making a song. But the whole idea of playing and also developing melody in your head was a big part of it as far as putting it together. So the songwriting, the songs came first, but the melodies and the playing came second. And once you have a couple that you have some successes with, and especially if you can actually sit down with somebody else and share that, and they happen to enjoy it or can chime in on their instrument, and you can actually see that writing a song can be something not only that's really good, but also can be a really great way for you to collaborate or connect with another, musician or vocalist, then that really, it trips your trigger. It makes you, makes you want to do more. So yeah, the songwriting came first, but a lot of it had to do with, as far as connecting with the instrument, the fact that, I wrote the words, but where's the melody? I mean, I can make chords and stuff like that, but, to actually say the song as opposed to singing the song, I hadn't trained my voice yet. So singing wasn't exactly, didn't come easy as far as putting things together and melody and so forth. But, over time that evolved too, and got better at that. So yeah, first the poetry and then the melody and the music came along later.
Okay, so when did you write your first song? I guess with the reference point of you learning Remember the Alamo, right?
Yeah.
How much longer before you wrote your first one, and what was the name of that song?
The cover tunes that came first for sure. I guess maybe I started those when I was, I don't know, maybe sixth or seventh grade. But in eighth grade, that's when I wrote my first, actually pulled off my first song, which is, you know, of course, written to a girl. It's called Brown Hair, Blue Eyes.
Oh, isn't it always about a girl? Isn't it?
Well, I mean, you know, it's the heart thing. It's the romance thing, you know. And also, her name was Kelly Young, and she was the first person I actually sat down and played music with. She played acoustic guitar, had her own songs. We figured we had each other's songs. She lived in Arizona, and I went over to her house, and we sat down and actually played. And we didn't do harmonies or anything, but, you know, it was fun, you know, sharing the songs because I liked what she did. She liked what I did. And so there was a connection there. And at the end of the day, having a positive experience like that, I mean, I don't know how many people do that, and it ends up being pretty crappy. As far as your first, you know, go around with somebody else and who's discovering music. But with Kelly, it was really quite simple, and it was very natural, and we enjoyed each other's product. So at the end of the day, she was the first, and that was a good song. I mean, it was beyond simple. But I only remember the first verse, which is actually the title of the song. So at yeah, it was a good start. And from there, just you know, took off to other things.
So you've been playing basically from, well, when we were young, you know, junior high, high school, you know, so you're a player. I mean, this is not something, you're not a beginner anymore. You've written songs, you're kind of progressing through. So how did you get your music heard?
Well, believe it or not, I really thought that after Kelly, she moved, and I thought that after Kelly, that other musicians or collaborations would open up, and they didn't. So that was kind of sad in its own way. But my parents, you know, God bless them, they realized how important all this was to me. So what they did was they got me as a Christmas present, a little teeny tiny, back in the day, reel-to-reel tape deck. You know, one of those things that has a crummy plug-in microphone, you know, and has the two little tiny, probably three-inch, you know, reel-to-reel things with the tape on them.
Right.
So you could maybe do one or two songs, you know, that's all you could put on there. So basically, I started recording onto that. And all of a sudden, all my discretionary income went to buying tapes so I could, you know, I wouldn't have to erase it, you know.
Just feed the habit.
To do the next one, yeah, you know. So, I got better at actually recording. At the first real thing I was really proud of, my dad went to Vietnam as a civil servant to work in the supply over there, supply chain. And basically, I recorded Remember the Alamo, okay, simply because I knew it. It was something that I could do and I could send over to him, and something he was actually familiar with as well. Recorded that and sent it over to him, and he enjoyed that. He told me when he got back that was something that was really special to him. So, I mean, you know, that made me realize that, you know, recording and sending tapes to people, which, of course, now, you know, it's just, you know, let me email you an MP3 or whatever the case might be, that sharing music through tape was a real eye-opener for me, because it not only made me realize I should look into what better equipment I could have, but also the fact that, you know, that was a way that I could connect with other people. Sure, they had to have a reel-to-reel tape deck in order to be able to hear it, but, you know, at least it was a, you know, stick my toe in the water in the engineering world and find that that was a way that I could actually use to share my music, which has actually, to this day, served me really, really well. So,
okay. Well, staying in the moment with your dad, did that like thicken the connection between y'all or initiate a connection between y'all, you sending him recordings over and on?
It did. I think it really made a nice connection, the fact that all those times that he was out in the garage and I was helping him doing one little thing or another, and the music was on, a lot of the songs that I or stuff that I would fool around with initially would be more along a folk or country vein, which that was his thing. So at the end of the day, the fact that I was leaning in that direction, I think he took a lot of pride in, a little ownership in, but also, I guess you could say in his younger years, he wrote a lot of poetry, which I didn't know about, until after he passed away. And we were looking through his personal stuff. And he actually typed letters to his mother during World War II and sent them to her, poems that he sent her, which I never knew that he wrote. And he didn't really talk about it. I don't know whether that was something that he really didn't really want to get into, whether he thought that writing poetry was, you know, not the masculine thing to do. But at the end of the day, he was a poet at heart. And that was a connection that I didn't know about, you know, him until after the fact. But I'm really glad that I found that out, because when I look back and reflect on all the times and all the songs and all the things, how the musical, you know, career and so forth, whether it's performing or recording, evolved over time, he was able to understand from a poet's point of view exactly what I was doing. And I think he got a lot of, you know, enjoyment and appreciation out of that.
That's really good. I mean, I think we all have a thing for our parents, as we should, and any kind of connection like that. Some people don't have that, unfortunately, but if you find it, I think it's a big deal, as life kind of goes on. So that's why I kind of wanted to ask about that. I didn't really know, so I just wanted to ask and to see if that was helpful in your relationship with your dad. So yeah, that's good stuff, man.
It is. And just as a little side note, the very, very first live performance that I ever did, a live gig that I ever did, was who was sitting in the front row but Mom and Dad. They were there. And so, you know, you think that Mom and Dad are, people have memories of them yelling at you for banging on your snare drum, but they didn't do anything to break my spirit or to interfere with what they saw as something really good for me at the time. I mean, I didn't know that, but what they did, and the fact that they were able to recognize that as a real positive thing with me, that, you know, shows just exactly how great they were.
I understand. I had parents that were the same way. I was a drummer anyway, so they put up with a whole bunch of racket. So I totally get where you're coming from. Oh, man. Wow. So now, okay, you kind of, your career from a collaborative standpoint kind of dried up, and that's sad. I feel like it's just sad when you want to hook up with people and you just the well is run dry. So that is junior high and high school.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. So, I mean, you went to Virginia Tech. What happened at Virginia Tech?
What happened at Virginia Tech was a continuation of writing for sure, and also just personal playing, even though there were a lot of really just, there were a lot of distractions, good distractions, I will say. You know, something that that basically were a very big part of my overall growth, you know, which is what college is all about. But then benchmark moment was me, just, I guess you could say, building a long-lasting friendship with Steve Gallagher, who is my best friend to this day. He had this constant, I guess you could say, need to experiment, but he also took the time to make sure that his instruments and his recording stuff was the finest possible to give him the most flexibility. He had a Martin D1235 and a Martin D28, two of the primo guitars of all time for us to use. And he also was the first kid on his block to get the TIAC, you know, four-channel sound-on sound deck, which he got while we were at college. And we put that to really good use. But, you know, he also built a stereo chair. We lived together for a while in the last 2 years I was up there. And he built this stereo chair, which was nothing more than two 4-inch Altec Lansing speakers, you know, in a little, you know, a little plywood thing with, you know, the speakers right next to your ear. So you're like sitting in this little enclosed area and you had the speakers right there. So experimenting with listening environments was a big part of it. But also we played, he had original material, I had original material. And over the last 2 years of college and probably the first three or four out of college, we really got together, made a point of getting together an awful lot and developed a nice style together, not only a style of playing acoustic guitars together, but also singing together. And also on top of that, engineering together, experimenting with engineering stuff. It was... He's to this day, we still experiment a lot, and he's a very, very big part of the success that I have and the growth that I had as a musician and also as a songwriter. So, yeah, college was transformative. And of course, once I finally, you know, got into publicly playing, that opens up a whole lot of you know, after college, that opened up a lot of, you know, connections as well. But Steve was without a doubt a launching point for everything that was going to follow.
Well, you know, that leads to the next question I have for you, because I feel like, I mean, with access to that kind of gear, which a lot of us didn't have, and you being at the right age to have all day.
Yeah, that was nice.
Yeah, I know, right? Because you don't, I mean, you have responsibility to get into class, you know, passing those classes, whatever, but really, you're not necessarily that adult grind. You're not in that adult grind yet. And so you had a lot of time. So did that experience, your junior and senior year, did that experience help you develop, you know, a studio workflow? And if it did, what was it?
Well, it did. But at our workflow would be, you know, taking, you know, 3 or 4 hours, and just sitting back and playing into the tape deck. We had songs we wanted to work on, but just getting the initial blast down so we would not forget it, so to speak, was a very big part of the moment, so to speak. There were times when you realized that you had shortcomings, like the quality of the microphones you were using. I mean, we didn't have high-end mics. We got what we could and used what we could. And of course, experimenting with mics and stuff like that was a big deal because you only have so much money. So you have to allocate, you know, well, this is a big purchase. What's the next thing going to be? So those were all part of the studio thing as well. But actually just getting things down on tape, not the quality, just so we could have it not only to listen back to, but also to play along to, or to do another version by adding this, that, or the other, or to change it around. That whole, session thing was not like a formalized session like I would have now, or even a casual session, like with somebody coming over and we'd just throw up a couple microphones and have a good time. That kind of thing was just, it reinforced the idea that if you put it on tape, then you have it as a reference. Right, the actual quality of the sound of the moment was not, I guess you could say, a prime concern, because we realized we didn't have the gear to get that. But to have those things recorded, and also with the four-channel sound-on-sound, to record on two channels the music as it was going through, and then go back and record the vocals. We could have two-part harmony, on the vocals. And so it was a learning experience that basically, taught us how to, I guess you could say, focus on, trying to get the best guitar sound, then focus on trying to get the best, vocal sound. Also bringing in reverb units and this kind of stuff and experimenting with that. You had to do it in the moment. There wasn't any going back and let me just add this because it's on the computer digitally. If you didn't do it live, it didn't get done. So that was old school, but it was great training. Which also makes me appreciate the fact that nowadays I can do so much with the tracks that I have after the fact, even though capturing those initial first take moments are always really special.
Understood. Now, you've graduated from college, and you went to college for a reason.
Went to be a teacher.
Yes, a very good teacher. Actually, I take that back. My bad. A great teacher.
Well, thank you, brother. I appreciate that.
Well, I know from experiences, I had you in my class. You had me in your class.
Yeah. You experienced my wrath and my glory.
It wasn't fun. It was not fun. I never had the chance to experience it personally because I wasn't stupid, but I saw it. Yeah, it wasn't good. But you went to Virginia Tech for a reason, and that was to be a teacher. But you were doing music seriously, I would say, as a minor. So after graduation, you tell the story.
Well, I got a job, as you know, at Indian River. I was teaching at the high school at the time, and it was a good experience. I loved the people at the River, both my students and my colleagues. They were great, but there was always that thing hanging over my shoulder it wasn't the desire to perform as much as it was to see exactly if I could take this anywhere. A performance would be a big part of it, of course, but to see if I could take my music someplace where it had never been. But I didn't see doing it while I was teaching. So I made the conscious decision to quit teaching after 1 year and got a job at the Midtown Holiday Inn playing solo acoustic. And it was a great paying job. Only had it for like 6 months, but at the end of the day, it was wonderful. I got a chance to meet Tanya there, which is a whole nother story. But the thing is that it opened up a chance for me to do the performing, and it also opened up connections to musicians that I would collaborate with for years down the road. Simply because they heard me doing my thing, they realized I could do covers, they realized I had original material. So, as a matter of fact, that I hooked up with Vernon Martin. I also hooked up with Herndon Edwards, because of that experience. And so it really was a big positive. But I don't like starving to death. And that's one thing after the 6 months was over. that I was doing. It was not pretty. So luckily, at that time, just about the time I was, you know, ready to pretty much cash things in, I got a call to come back and teach at Indian River, but this time at the junior high school. And I realized that my love of teaching was still there, and I wanted to reengage with that. But also, my love of music was now firmly a part of it. So I needed to make the decision, and I made it consciously that I could actually do both. There's no reason in the world that I would need to stop one career and in order to be able to do another. I could do them both. It would take work and time, but at the end of the day, I had a woman I was with who understood exactly, you know, what all this was all about. She's, you know, my wife of 45 years. So she understands and understood then, understands now. And so I was able to do both. And it's just been an enriching, you know, lifestyle, to say the least, which has evolved into all kinds of beautiful, you know, collaborations and, you know, different things along the road, both performing and in the studio.
Okay, well, let's go back. As you mentioned this a couple of times since you've been answering this particular question. Now, that gig, it only lasted 6 months, but it gave you everything.
It did.
And that everything, and we all love her. I know I do. So tell us what that gig really gave you.
Well, what it gave me was the beginning of my relationship with Tanya. I mean, like, I got some you know, performing chops down pat, and got skill sets and working with, you know, really primitive PA stuff. But the number one thing was the connection with Tanya. Tanya is, or at that time, was the day bartender at the Midtown Holiday Inn. And she had a friend, Janet, who worked the evening shift. And Janet gave her a call, said, you know, you need to come out. You love acoustic music. You need to come out and listen to this guy. So she did. I can remember seeing her for the first time sitting in the audience. She was a stunner. She's beautiful. And she was sitting there smoking her cigarette and just, you know, listening attentively, and, you know, came up and said, would you like to come over and have a conversation? I said, sure. And we had a wonderful conversation that night. At end of the day, she took me home with her, and we've been together ever since. I mean, it's a wonderful relationship. She's incredibly musical. And she plays keyboards. She has a beautiful voice, a very low, sexy female voice, which, you know, has been very attractive both on stage and in the studio. She understands every aspect of the business. She understands what it's like to be in a performing situation. She understands what it's like to be in the studio situation. She's a first take artist in the studio. I mean, don't let anybody kid you. This woman knows what she's doing in the studio, and she does it really, really well. But, you know, she has understood and supported me. I think probably the thing that really attracted me to her and just sold me on that this is the person I got to have for the rest of my life is the fact that she, out of all the people that I've ever known outside of my parents, she is the one who has believed in me the most. And so meeting her there at the very first gig, I don't know whether that's destiny or happenstance or whatever the case might be. Karma, whatever, but it was gigantic in terms of, you know, steering me and the course of my life in all the right directions.
That I find amazing. And I asked you that on purpose because I think it's worth hearing over and over again. Because, I mean, sometimes it doesn't happen like a TV show. In your case, it did. So that's always a warm story to me. So thank you for sharing that. Thank you for sharing that.
Well, I got lucky. I mean, that's all there is to it. I got lucky. I mean, if Janet hadn't called her, if Tanya hadn't come down, I mean, you know, if we hadn't started living together, I mean, there's so many ifs in there. But, you know, it was all positive. And also, you know, in terms of a husband-wife relationship, even before we got married, Tanya shifted to the night shift as far as bartending. So basically we could be together, and we would both go home together, you know, same car, and we would stop usually like 1 or 1 o'clock, 1:30 in the morning. And we're the only ones on the road, and we stop in an all night diner, and we had that conversation that it'd just be us, You know, we got home, it would just be us. We sleep late. Everybody else is at work. It's just us. So we were able to cement our relationship and really get to know each other and appreciate each other a lot in the early days, simply because of the schedule that we both had and the enjoyment that we had of spending time together.
Understood. So that leads into, well, you know, obviously Tanya's your biggest collaborator, like for your whole life.
Oh yeah.
But just from a musical standpoint, which she, you know, she's your biggest collaborator there too. But other than Tanya, from a musical standpoint, what are some of the artists, or all the artists, if you want to tell us, you know, that you collaborated with in the beginning? When I say the beginning, when you were really playing as a pro.
In the earliest, I guess you could say there are two experiences in the very, very beginning that really had a strong impact on me. One was working with the Herndon Edwards Band. I got my first professional studio experience with them up at Track Studio in Maryland, Silver Springs, Maryland. And they had good songs. We harmonized really well together. I was like, you know, backup harmony and the acoustic and rhythm guitar guy. But also I brought, you know, that wealth of, you know, country acoustic rock experience to the group, which and I played with them for almost 2 years after recording with them, which was fun because I got a chance to see exactly what to do and what not to do in terms of a full band situation on stage, which was a big deal. The second, I think, was with Tanya. We started singing in a trio called Cimarron, which was myself, Tanya, and Vernon Martin, who is one of the most talented musicians I've ever played with. He sang like a bird, just a gorgeous voice, and had a real folk, country, bluegrass kind of acoustic background. He could play really, really well. He could play a lot of very professionally recognized stylings, which basically I couldn't play. I'm a simple rhythm guy and a simple finger picking guy, but he had brought a lot of the more commercial sounding acoustic stuff to the act. But at, you know, the biggest plus out of that group was learning how to sing together. Tanya and Vernon and I had some great harmony moments. There's no doubt about it. I got the recordings. I got the videos. I mean, it's there. And people still appreciate it, you know, when I post them every once in a while. The end of the day, learning how to actually sing and blend, not just to sing the harmonies, but how to blend them on stage to where they come through a PA and people could actually really appreciate them. It's not just engineering. It's how you do it, how you sing it. And that's very much a part of how, I guess you could say, I learned how to engineer that through a PA because I was running the board, was the first step. But how do you actually engineer that resonance in a studio? That was an education with Tanya and Vernon. It was an education as to know when you actually hit that moment. In other words, when we sang together and hit those harmony moments and they were actually, you know, like a tuning fork going off in your entire body, that moment, how do you get that actually on tape and mixed and mastered to where it sounds and feels like that when it comes across in a recording? So they were, it was so much fun, you know, to be on stage and do that with them. It was a learning proposition all the way to the late 80s, which was the last time we actually performed with Vernon. There was an awful lot there. It also built my confidence as far as my solo singing ability. I really enjoy the idea of harmonizing with people because, you know, I didn't sing lead all the time. I mean, I had Tanya and Vernon who had great lead vocal capability. So I was singing background harmony a lot too. And that, you know, was another skill set. How do you actually find a harmony in your range that'll really make whatever collaboration you're working with sound good? And I learned that with them. So those two groups, Herndon Edwards and Cimarron, were really, I guess you could say, benchmark moments for me in terms of enjoyment, but also in terms of studio and performance skills.
Penultimate question. What were some of your favorite moments, songs, or sessions over this time in your career till this moment?
Oh, man. That's a great question, but that's really hard to answer. I guess no major song or anything like that. There were some doing all the stuff before I got in, to professional studios and eventually had my own studio, experimenting with Stevie, there were little aha moments where you actually came up with a harmony, or you had a mic that actually really worked on a guitar or a vocal, where you found the right, you know, special effects mix or something like that somewhere down the road. Those were wonderful, you know, revelations. But as far as in the studio, I think probably some of the best times that I've had have been the moments that were first take moments. People who have been in the studio can really appreciate these things because they are so rare. One that comes to mind, which it will always stick with me, will always be with me, is working with Greg Weichel. I worked with Greg with Bob Smith, working on, Bob was the engineer of the Calm Before the Storm album at Earworks. And Bob had invited me over and invited Greg over at the same time, which I didn't know. Many years passed and wanted us to work on an acoustic music thing for a commercial he was working on in the studio for, you know, some kind of radio spot. Well, the connection I had with Greg at the time was immediate. I don't know. I didn't know him from a hill of beans, but, you know, we played together right from the get-go like we had been playing together for ages. And so that ended up being a really good introduction to each other and a really good recording experience. And then all of a sudden, you know, I didn't follow up on it for whatever reason, didn't get his phone number, whatever. But about 10 years later, I remembered how good that was. And so I dug around and asked people and got his phone number, got in touch with him, and actually said, hey, would you like to work on some songs on a new album, especially one song that I think you and I could do really, really well. And that song was called By the Fence in the Sun, which was the title track for the upcoming CD. So I sent it to him and said, you know, figure out some guitar stuff and we'll have a good time when you come over. Well, after about 3 or 4 weeks, he came over and he didn't have a guitar. He had his mandolin with him. I said, okay. So we, you know, I was living at the Cosmopolitan. We were talking on the way up. I already had the studio set up and everything. We had, you know, he met Tanya for the first time. You know, it was just really kind of nice, but all new. The first time I seen him in 10 years. So we got in the studio. I shut the door. Both of us tuned up. I got the levels, what his mandolin level, my guitar level, my vocal level. We're all, you know, set. And then it was 1, 2, 3, and then bam, you know, we played the song. We did not rehearse it. I had never heard it with the mandolin before. You know, this was fresh. I mean, as raw as you could possibly get it. And it ended up being stellar. I swear to this day, it chokes me up to think about how good that moment was. And the fact that I had the tape deck on and captured that, it was, you know, it's the first song on the album. It should be, because it shows how two musicians can just really, even after a 10-year hiatus and didn't have any rehearsal or anything or whatsoever, how two guys could understand and serve a song so well and have such a good time doing it. Once you listen to that recording, you'll understand. It's just an amazing moment. And there have been other moments like that with Greg and other people, but that one really left the strongest, I guess you could say, impression on me in terms of what can be accomplished when two people get together and have that magic happen.
One, two, three. Supper fence, 100 yards along the road, thinking we could maybe get a few things done with someone there to share the load. Dig a hole and cut a log, put them in there one by one. Take no time at all, working hard and having fun. sun with my daddy. Put the rock down on the road to help you make it through the snow. A few days gone, I think there's gonna be some more. Where in the world did it all go? Down in Jacksonville, they all lay out in rows, still together side by side. Never really know. They did their best to love the ride. Raise your head and say a prayer. Send it to them one by one. Always think of them as dead. Working hard and having fun by the fence in the sun. Hole and cut a log. Send it to them one by one. Didn't take no time at all. Working hard and having fun by the fence in the sun with a daddy.
Great moment.
No kidding.
Well, having said all the things that you've said, what is your take on you?
Well, musically, personally, for the most part, I'm a very happy guy. My life is actually really quite simple. I get into a lot of things, but you know, I'm looking right now over to my right, and I have three of the finest instruments ever made. I have my square neck dobro, my lap steel, and my guitar. I play them all the time. I enjoy them. I keep my chops up, but it's a way, of course, of me just enjoying music. They're excellent instruments. It took me over 40 years to accumulate these three instruments, but you know, it over time that they just kind of came. And of course, Tanya has always been supportive and understood the moment when I actually needed to step up and buy an instrument that was worthy of my skill set at the time. So, I mean, I have my instruments, I have my home studio, I have a circle of friends, you included, who are talented and understanding and supportive of everything that I do. And basically, if it wasn't for this pandemic, we'd be doing sessions right now. My rule of thumb is first the shots and then the sessions. We're going to do it right. I make sure that everybody stays healthy. But, I mean, I have that to look forward to. In the interim, I've already put down the basic tracks for most of the songs I want to work on and sent them off to all the people I want to have work with me that are in my part of my circle of friends and collaborators. I have to be a patient man because I'm chomping at the bit to get in there and do it so I can finish them. But, you know, I'd much rather, you know, have that happen when it happens. Tanya and I, our lives, especially during the pandemic, have been simplified. We stay at home a lot, but I have a lot to do at home. I have my, of course, you know, Radio Siva and Siva Sound. We have that to work on, you and I. And also, you know, there's always new material that I'm working on to get ideas for and put down initial cuts for. There's just so much going on. I don't think that I could have a fuller life. I also try as best I can to never take on more than I actually have the time for, because hanging out with Tanya, hanging out with Barry, our favorite dog, the studio dog, doing this with things like this with you and with Malcolm, you know, also just, you know, just a general recording. I don't perform anymore, except when asked. So at the end of the day, it's a good life, and I owe it all to the people that that have been a part of an intimate part of my life, but also owe it to you know, the educational part of my life, my students and my colleagues in education who mean so much to me. I'm still in contact with them. But on the musical side, it's you know, I still have my skill set. I can still sing. My voice hasn't really diminished an awful lot over time. And so that in and of itself, the amount of enjoyment and the amount of pleasure and the amount of satisfaction that I have living the life that I have is really quite exceptional. It's very fulfilling. When it comes right down to it, I have a lot of people who I feel incredibly close to because of performing or recording or just personal life experiences. People that I've had great conversations with. Some of the conversations I've had with these people have been totally musical, but they've been beautiful. So, you know, it's all the same thing. But I also know that those people, for the most part, all of them have lives. They have significant others. They have children. They have parents. You know, they have issues of life that everybody deals with. And so getting together socially or musically sometimes is very, very difficult. But right from the beginning, with you and I, we've made the time, because basically there's a lot of things that we've utilized, whether it be, you know, Zencastr or Squadcast or Zoom or just getting together personally, which of course is always the juice. It's always fun. We've, you know, put together a business. We've recorded. You've been a recording engineer for some of the most memorable recent tracks that I've had, since we haven't gotten into that until recently. We also have the SivaCast that we've done together. There's a long history, and it all started, you know, with a Facebook, you know, message connection. Let's get together. Tom, I want to look over your shoulder to maybe sponge a little engineering stuff off of you. Is that okay? And we just took off from there. I mean, what a really nice, you know, beginning to a relationship which has spawned so many positive things for both of us. I'll ask you the question. What was it that actually, you know, prompted you to get in touch with me to have that first get together, look over your shoulder at the Cosmopolitan moment?
Well, for me, well, first of all, I can't start there. I got to start from the beginning. So I'll start from the beginning. Since we're going to talk about this, let's talk about it. So, I was not always Tom's partner. I was not always a host on his show. I used to be a snot-nosed student of his. That's how all of this started. So I was in seventh grade, and I had gone to the office for something. It wasn't because I was in trouble, because that was rare. But I was in the office for something, and while I was waiting to be attended to, I look up to my left, and up on the wall closer to the ceiling was the album cover for Songsmith. And I was like, that's that dude. What? And so I had asked, this is like, is that like a real record? That's Mr. Farley. And I was like, wow. So after that moment, and my wife, we went to school together, and all of our friends, we all had this moment, but this is mine. So it's just like, I never looked at him the same again, ever. And, you know, he was like, I was shorter than I am now, which I'm not at all to start with. And so for somebody that is north of 6 foot, it's like, it's that extra intimidation. And so I'm like, this dude is like doing it. I mean, what? So a couple of years later in ninth grade, I had him as a history teacher. I have not learned history quite as much as I have in that year that I had him. It was enjoyable. It was stressful because some of the things, that assignment that you gave me or gave us, where we had to write a paper and it did have to have some length. I don't know how many words it needed to be, but it had to be perfect. That is the most stressful time of my life. I just want you to know that. I was like,
well, that's the,
and the only guy,
that's the English, huh? That's English major in me coming out, man. I definitely believed in, you know, the writing thing. So I'm sorry. I didn't mean to put you through such pain.
Man, I still remember getting that assignment. And I'm like, how in the world? You said I was close, but no cigar. But anyway, it was a great experience. You were just a great teacher. So
thank you, buddy. I appreciate it.
Not a problem, because it's all true. So I'm like, you know, ninth grade's over, 10th grade, graduate. And just life happens. And so I'm like, I'm almost 50, you know, and I'm on Facebook and I see you. And so we're friends. And I thought that was cool as is. And I was like, hey, that's kind of cool. But at the same time, my own musical journey had taken me to a place with a serious hiatus, but it taken me to a place where it always needed to be. And I always wanted it to be, which was recording. I never really kind of dug performing necessarily. I think me being an introvert a little bit, I just never really wanted to deal with people, a lot of people at once, and having to be on like that. So yeah. I always wanted to, you know, kind of understand how records were made, you know, how the sausage was made, how the hamburger was made. And all of that came from a frustration for me because, you know, as I said earlier in this podcast, you know, my parents bought me my first drum kit and I was a little irritated, not at them, but I was a little irritated that my snare drum did not sound like Rick Allen's snare drum. If you don't know who he is, he is the drummer for Def Leppard. And I was a little heated. I didn't understand that. And so over time I learned this and that, but it was really a mystery to me. So I had started my engineering career much later in life. But I always knew that Tom had the goods. This guy had been doing it for a minute. So I had gotten my first mix and I didn't realize, you know, how awful the song was. The song itself was good, but the performances were awful and just, it wasn't really good. It wasn't a good starter song for, you know, a good song for a starter engineer. It just destroyed my confidence and I didn't know what to do with it. And so, you know, I said, maybe if I talk to Mr. Farley, I can kind of get some insight on just how to arrange this. Because I was lost. I was like, oh my goodness, this is awful. I mean, I could handle it now, but then I just didn't know what I was doing. And then to get something like that, it can hurt your confidence. So, and that's how all of this started. I messaged him and he said, yeah, come on by, blah, blah, blah. And I remember feeling like I was in ninth grade again, but it was all cool. It was all cool. And that day, what happened was I formatted the jump drive I had the wrong way. And I live like, you know, 40 minutes away. And I just made this big snafu that kind of ruined the day for what I was supposed to be there for. However, I think a friendship was, you know, kind of sprouted from a basic question. And we were talking and, you know, just talking or whatever. And so that conversation went well, even though I kind of wasted our time. So we got together again. And so during that conversation, I asked a question that I had, you know, in between the first one and that moment. That question was, have you ever thought about doing loops? You have 40 years of experience doing this.
I remember that so clearly.
Yes. And so I was like, because I remember being at work going, this guy has been doing this for like 30 or 40 years, I know. Because I remember 30, 35 years ago, I saw Songsmith. So that means that you had been doing it way before then.
Oh, yeah.
And so I'm like, I wonder if he's ever thought about doing his own loop library. Because I know you were telling me how, you know, some of the songs that you had written, you know, all the instruments that you couldn't play, drums or whatever, you use loops extensively. And I was like, ah, that's really cool. But have you ever thought about writing your own? And so that's how all of this started.
I can remember when you said that to me. I can remember the moment. We were sitting in there in the studio, and you know, it was a real aha moment. I mean, because at that particular point, the loops that I had used back in like 2006 for Over the Falls were basic, but they had, you know, they were lacking a certain audio aural, you know, tonal quality. They didn't feel quite right. So, but by the time you and I got together, the loops I was using were professionally, you know, recorded inside studios. They were the bomb. I mean, the sonic quality, the audio was just excellent. And I could engineer them to the point where I could make it sound like a real drummer, a real bass player, that just knew exactly what the hell they were doing. And so the loop thing had become much more part of the, I guess you could say, the presence of mind as far as the recording is concerned. When you said that, you know, I thought to myself, you know, ever since 2016, because the stuff for the Calm Before the Storm album and Songsmith were on analog tapes, and those tapes had long since flaked their way into oblivion, you know. So, I mean, I had the overall things, but didn't have the individual tracks. But from Over the Falls forward, I had all the tracks, you know, from all the recording sessions. And I thought, you know, there's got to be some good stuff in there that we could actually chop out. And the more I thought about it, the more it made sense. And then you stepped in and basically said, well, if you want to do it, I can engineer it. If you chop them out, I can make them ready for use on somebody's DAW. And there, that was a defining moment in terms of a great project for us to start off with, because basically I had the product and you had the I guess you could say the avenue in order to be able to process it. Even though that avenue of processing loops was not the main thing that you were doing at the time, you embraced it and became really good at it. And so as time went on, the libraries just started, you know, coming, and it was, you know, it was a great way for us to introduce each other to a really good recording and studio experience, and also give us a chance to talk and get to know each other better. It was just, you know, it was all upside, no downside to it at all.
True. That. So, yeah, that one question led to a lot of things, but that also led to the second question, which was, if you want to promote, and by the way, whoever's listening to this, this is happening. We live in Southeast Virginia, so you have a point of reference. So I'm sitting here thinking about this. I spend a lot of time at work, and I have a lot of time to think at times. And so I'm thinking about this. It's like he keeps pushing this area. He cares so much about this area. And we had kind of kicked, you know, maybe I had mentioned, or you had mentioned or something, about, you know, the proliferation of internet radio. It's been around forever, but it's a big deal now.
Oh yeah.
And so,
yeah, it is.
You know, you're talking, you're really passionate. Sometimes you even tear up about it. And I'm like, whoa, why don't you just do a station? Why don't we just do a station? How much could it be? And then that led to this moment we're in right now.
That's right.
That one question. That one notion led to everything that happened after the loop libraries that we produced, which is,
you know,
Radio Siva, your opportunity to do what we're doing right now, this particular podcast, plus the podcast we do with our own artists, which is SivaCast.
That's right.
That one question led to all of this.
Well, you know, that that also, when you mentioned that, There is a history as far as my personal experience is concerned. I have pet peeves that follow me all my life. Slow drivers in the left-hand lane is a pet peeve. people pulling my tie when I, you know, when I used to wear one, that's a pet peeve. And the fact that local radio would never, except in a very odd moment, would never ever broadcast the recording artists in the area consistently as part of their platform on a regular rotation, especially after corporate took over FM radio. You know, you can pretty much kiss that goodbye. That's over 30 years ago. Even wrote a letter to the editor about it and posted it on my website, just so, you know, people will ever want to read it. But that has always been, you know, a real big thing in terms of not only as an artist, but also in the music business. I mean, you know, and when you said that, it just clicked. It's like, okay, all the tumblers just kind of fell in place. What better way in the world to actually promote the sound of this area, the recording artists in this area, not just cover. We don't do covers. We do all originals. And these people are great songwriters. They're great players. They have good production. These people, along with yours truly, need to be heard. And so after doing the research into the radio station, I found a platform with Live 365, which seemed to, you know, they're young and hungry and they seem to be, you know, into it. And we actually launched this thing. And we also built a business of Siva Sound as a business to actually encapsulate the loops and the licensing and the radio station and now the podcast. I mean, you know, it's all part of the growth using both of our skill sets and both of our ideas. It's just, you know, it's a win-win all the way around. And I can tell you right now, the building of the station has been slow and has been an educational curve for sure. But we know how to do it now. And I think that over time, more artists will join and the sound will become fuller and fresher. And I look forward to the artists that we have right now. We got over 40 artists now. I look forward to their new material, their new releases. It reinforces the fact that not only are these people good, but these people still have the passion and the spirit, whether they're performing artists or whether they're just recording artists. The Steely Dans of the world, you know, who do very little performing, but do marvelous things in the studio. That allowed us to actually not only do that for them, but to get in contact with that part of ourselves and actually make that a reality. And I think that the area is better off for it. I know the musicians who are on the station are better off for it. And there are those, that handful of people, the musicians who are on the station who truly believe in what we're doing. Promoted at almost every turn. So yeah, it has spawned new relationships, and it makes me feel good to be able to put their sound out there in such a really positive way. And together, collectively, we are definitely you know, the sum of our parts is greater. You know, I forget the exact phrase. We are greater than the sum of our parts is what it is. The radio station will continue on to be a real good positive force for letting people hear what kind of music we have here. It's important. And I can't believe that local businesses and local radio have not, they've not even, you know, they haven't changed a lick in over 30 years. It's amazing. You ask a musician that's playing right now, who's in Southeast Virginia, when you're out there, the same money you're getting for a solo gig or the same money that your band is getting is the same money that I was getting 35, 40 years ago. What the hell is that all about? It shows you that the recording artists and the musicians who are definitely deserving of good pay when they perform, that hasn't translated into the business community at all. So, you know, hopefully people hearing and supporting these people even more will translate into them having a better chance to, you know, not only to have their music heard, but also to make a living if they want to off of the playing of their music.
I mean, that's your message. It's always been your message. So I hear you. And again, our relationship has gotten that here, all those things.
That's right.
So I think that's one of the two most important things about it. And the other thing for me personally, having nothing to do with music, is just gaining a new friend. And I think it's really odd because it's like, I never thought I'd be your friend because my relationship with you was never that. But to see, you know, where it's gone, and it took, you know, it took 40 years to get here, but I've arrived here, and it's a good thing. And I enjoy you being in my life. I enjoy your friendship, and I enjoy who you are as a person. And so that's the relationship. That's why I'm on this podcast. That's why this is going to feel a certain way. And it was worth talking about.
Well, I agree. As part of the program that we like to talk about in the development of the shows for Silent Voices, it's the intersection. I mean, we intersected back in Indian River, but the intersection as adults with similar loves and similar passions and similar ideas, and also just the comfortable aspect. I feel like I can talk to you about anything. And our conversations that we have on our own, out of the studio and so forth, that people don't really hear, are ones that are formative and have a really a kind of a depth and a humor and experience. Both of us coming from, you know, whatever places we're coming from over our lives, it's always been good. And I feel like I can talk to you about anything. And I also have, you've helped me in questions in terms of just the whole industry in terms of podcasting, because I know that you are developing your own podcast business, which, you know, is not an easy thing to do, especially, you know, with the engineering requirements and the personal requirements that are required to actually make a really good podcast show, which you are mastering, you know, better and better every single week that you're into it. But, you know, a lot of people don't have that kind of honesty, okay, and respect when it comes to working with others. We put an awful lot on the line. Some of it requires certainly a personal commitment, but also a financial commitment. And we both stuck to our original, you know, Farley Riddick, you know, the beginning thing that we actually started off with before it evolved into Siva Sound and everything that's, you know, and Radio Siva and everything that follows, all those things combined to make friendship happen and work. And I just, you know, I just feel so blessed to have you in my corner, buddy. That's all there is to it.
It's great stuff, Tom. I appreciate you, you know, wearing it on your sleeve for this. I think this is a great introduction to everything that we're going to be doing on this podcast. Let people know who you are, how you got from A to B. So thank you, sir.
Oh, you're welcome, buddy. This has been fun. It has. It's always fun with you.
Thank you, sir.
This episode was produced by Tom Farley and Alton Riddick. Edited and mixed by Alton Riddick for Edit Your Truth. And a big thank you to Silent Voices International Radio for having us. On behalf of Tom, this is Alton signing off until we meet again on The Path Taken.